Welcome to Curators of Culture. In today's episode, we will talk with the one and only Prevail, from one of Canada's greatest export hip-hop groups, the infamous Swollen Members. From their origin story in a trailer in North Vancouver, to getting dissed by Maestro Freshwares and shouted out by the one and only Drake, Swollen Members have seen it all. Prevail, himself, is a four-time Juno award-winning artist who was born and raised in Victoria, British Columbia, and groomed for success in Vancouver's deeply rooted snow and skate scene. Prevail and Swollen Members are enigmatic legends who are known worldwide for defining a time in hip-hop culture that will never be repeated.
I think with any group, you look at the groups that have longevity, and there's one underlying theme or one mainstay there is that everyone respects each other's vision as artists and respect each other as people. Are you going to have squabbles and disagreements creatively and personally? Yeah, as you would in any 20-year relationship, 20-plus year relationship. But I think that's one of the things that has definitely tailored part of our strength around mutual respect.
He never tried to claim I'm a freestyle champion, blah, 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 blah. This guy can freestyle better than fucking 99% of the world. Prev, I want you to do the whole thing again right now. Show what you got. I said, show what the fuck you got. Show what you got.
I grew up in a Marvel universe, but I've slowly started to respect DC. The same way that I grew up in hip-hop culture and slowly started to respect the DJ, the B-boy, the B-girl, the graffiti writer, and the MC. It doesn't just happen overnight. That's what they call a copyright. That's what they call an overwrite. Jump on my shit, that's what they call an overwrite. It's over, good night. Have a good time. I hope you have a good rhyme. If you don't, you won't last here. That shit was so last year. You might see your past clearly in the mirror and realize that the thing that you see is what you actually fear.
I live by this one line. Are you concerned with being right, or are you focused on getting the right thing done? I always loved writing poetry. I always loved acting. I was always in theater since third grade. When I realized that I could blend those two things together, and my cousin from the East Coast introduced me to rap music and hip-hop culture, and I realized I could put everything together, that's when it became, when I knew that I wanted to do music. I grew up in Victoria, but by osmosis, Vancouver's definitely was a rock town, but I grew up on rock. I love that. I actually didn't, if it was Canadian and it was coming out, like any other music, you either like it or you don't. I never really started to regionalize things like that, but certainly when, you know, Bryan Adams came out, or, you know, Tragically Hip, or some bands that I really looked up to. I really liked Alanna Miles. You know, there were some bands that you definitely glommed onto and appreciated, and then you had that sort of prideful moment to say, and they're Canadian.
In the beginning, all I hear is people singing, deep and low, with iron bells ringing. And there's a source of heat near my feet. I'm so weak, I passed in and out of
sleep. Bad Dreams appeal to both underground and mainstream audiences. What do you think is the magic ingredient that made this possible?
Again, I have to sort of harken back to the point that we allowed everyone to be truthful, whether it was Rob being truthful in the music, or whether it was Matt and I being truthful and allowing each other to celebrate our individual voices. I think that's what really has helped sculpt that dynamicism of Swollen Members, whether underground or above ground. We really never sought to make commercial hits. We were just lucky enough that what we loved doing did have some commercial success in certain time periods of our career.
Come on, 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 come on,
ski, snowboard, skate scene. You guys were affiliated with Red Dragon, the Wildcats, Sligo Bruce, Cal Steffens, Danny Way back in the day.
All the boys.
Can you tell us about how some of the stories of skateboarding, snowboarding, and the scene in Vancouver, and how that helped to propel you guys into the limelight and then move forward into the international scene?
Well, we were very lucky in that when we first started, I was living with still a dear friend, Heather, who was working for Sean Kearns at the time. We were just kind of getting to the point of making tunes. It's interesting when people are at those stages of building something. So, you know, you got someone like Sean Kearns, and you got someone like the Wildcat crew, and you got the Forum Posse and Whistler, and like Tyler Shelley was driving our first Canadian tour. And you realize, hey, we got music you guys can have for free, and you need music for free, because everyone's sort of producing these things at this very upstart level. And it just became this really great channel of communication, you know, with Dev, like Devin Walsh. And we just, it was honestly, it was a cool time, and it was Sluggo and Dave were always just great to us. RDS crew always just absolutely awesome to us. Peter and the whole crew. And so they needed music, we needed exposure, and it just kind of came hand in hand.
Fight a gangster with a handcuff to locked up. Drink Pepsi Cola, same friends, still rolling, still swollen. Only difference is the heat that I'm holding.
Well, Black Magic was cool only because we had talked about doing another record. Matt had just opened the Battle Axe Studios and record label. So basically, you had this really cool facility where you go up in the elevator, and the entry level was the record label functioning. Then you'd go upstairs and you had the recording studio, and then you'd go to the back of the hallway and Matt was living there. And so it was just this all-encompassing kind of interesting compound, if you will, for lack of a better word. And I think we were on tour. I was somewhere else traveling, and we had talked about doing another record, and Rob had sent the beat for Black Magic, and I can't remember exactly why I got stoked on trying to look this up, but I just had rewatched Gattaca. And so I was trying to figure out, they had this line in there, the structure of the human body. So I looked up what the structure of the human body meant in Latin. So my opening line for the first line of the title song for the album was De Humani Corporis Fabrica, the structure of the human body, welcome to Gattaca. And I was like, yo, I just wrote my first line ever in Latin. And it got me stoked. And that just, for whatever reason, it sparked this new writing direction for me for that album.
You feeling the same pain? Can't feel what we don't understand. Come back down beneath, heads high, upper hand. Black magic.
You guys won multiple Much Music Awards in the Canadian music scene. What was it like to be precursor to the Sixth and Drake's overtaking of hip-hop culture, and what kind of influence do you think that you gave those people that took your torch and took it further than you guys had taken it?
Well, to be totally honest, we were lucky enough to have that torch passed to us from, you know, people like Maestro, from Mishimi, HDV, who was a little bit more underground, but definitely well-respected. We're by no means the Rascals, by no means were we the first Canadian rap group to make noise. And I feel that it's such a, you know, hip-hop culture in Canada, everyone that's very inclusive, everyone is very welcoming of each other's output and input. So it was awesome. And in fact, before Drake became the Drake that most people are familiar with now, he actually did a song called Black Magic over the Black Magic beat from Swollen. And I thought that was very endearing. You gotta love it. Chaos, Cardinal, The Weeknd, although I don't know if you can classify, I don't know how you classify The Weeknd, he's so multi-genre, but it's just awesome, man, to be part of a successive lineage. You want that, don't you? You want to be able to have the elders pass you the mantle and you pass that forward, otherwise it just dies. Who wants to see something that they've worked so hard for just dissipate? That doesn't make sense to me. So yes, I'm proud of all our Canadian hip hop and rap artists.
Accommodations for one at Heartbreak Hotel, the place you stay when crazy loving doesn't go so well. It's I spent the night bright and early on checkout. Heavy life lessons, reservations.
So far you've released 11 albums. What exciting projects are you working on now? What are your plans for the future?
Well, I'm glad you asked that. So we're in Australia till for another 5 or 6 days. After this I fly to Italy to record an EP with my nephew and our new band called AOXLP, so a pre-existing band called Leisure Principle. My nephew and I have a rap group called Alpha Omega that Rob actually does all the mixes for, and we've sort of formed this super side project group, which is just nasty, called AOXLP, so Alpha Omega meets Leisure Principle, and I'm super stoked on it. On the rap, underground rap tip, Alpha Omega, my nephew and I just opened for Bliss and Esso in Victoria for Rifflandia, and we've talked about doing some cross collaborative stuff, and there's some whispers of some potential things coming up in the future, which I won't divulge on right now, but let's just say I look forward to spending a lot more time in Australia in the future.
More of a seven, I'll never know, never been, never could. Letter to sever the tide that makes it so. Read it slow, burn away, cursed when it hurts to think. Thirsty drink, toast to this, passes that. Tribe, you must, feelings of lust will bring the magic back. I'm sorry.
Where do you see Swollen members in the next 5 years?
It's a great question. We definitely have a legacy that we feel that, and we've talked about this even recently, as recently as this evening. We really feel that we have a heritage and a legacy that we want to make sure that we can look back on with complete satisfaction internally. If we win another Juno, awesome. If we sell another 100,000 records, awesome. Barring those monetary or commercially or pop culture recognized milestones, I think we all want to be able to walk away from what we've built together with a smile on our faces and a sense of pride. So I think we're still built for the road. We're tour ready. We're tour. We love it. We're old dogs. As far as the tour circuit goes, we love it. And I think it keeps us young, keeps us kind of chomping at the bit. So, but we also realize that being able to do that, you can't rely on your past catalog. Sometimes you also have to have some new music out. So I think we're pretty comprehensive in the scope of what we'd like to do in the next 5 to 6 years. But ultimately it ends in being able to look at our discography and our history and be proud of it.
What we do, yeah, almost famous. Now I wonder if they've heard of us. Together we are one. When I'm alone, it's just a third of us. It's family. Bond is even deeper than blood. Cause we choose to stick together while we creep through the mud. And walk through the fire. We've been to heaven and hell. But when we were at the bottom, fuck it, nobody bailed. That's why we got a bond that's even deeper than blood. Because we choose to stick together while we creep through the mud.
Almost famous. You're my name. That's only giving me props. Almost famous. It was a long, hard struggle, but I managed to.